Superman. What does he have to do with science? Let's have a closer look. Even the mighty Superman is constructed of building blocks. But can you tell what role this simple brick will finally acquire in the whole organism? To build the organism, you need first to replicate the building blocks to a large quantity and then instruct them to a specific destination and function. Stem cells, which are the subject of my talk, are very similar. This simple-looking, small brain stem cell does not know to perform the complex task of specialized brain cells. Well, the thing that makes it so special is its potential. Its potential that makes it the resource from which brain tissue is generated. First, it can proliferate, here after a couple of days, and then to form a sphere of stem cells, and then the cells can be instructed to stop proliferating, to migrate out of the sphere, and to acquire an identity. Or in biological terms, to differentiate into one of the various types of specialized brain cells, such as the different neurons and the various supporting cells of the brain. Now, our brain has very limited capacity to repair itself. So almost 20 years ago, when I started working with stem cells, it was with a very naive notion that we will use stem cells to replace missing and damaged cells and tissues in the brain. We thought that we will grow stem cells in culture, inject them into the injured tissue in the brain, and that the cells will manage to integrate in the complex brain network and fix it. As it turned out, surprisingly turned out, we found, our work showed, that stem cells have different additional therapeutic properties that we did not think of. We found that transplanted stem cells can affect their local surrounding in powerful, beneficial effects. Think of the injured brain as a burning forest. You can try and plant new trees. Maybe they'll survive. Probably not, but if you pour water, it will put out the fire, and at the same time, it will start the growth of surviving plants to renew the forest in a natural way. And very similarly, transplanted stem cells can inhibit inflammatory processes in the brain that cause injury, and they can protect the actual brain cells from death, and they can even promote and facilitate repair processes that are performed by the brain's own cells. These repair processes are the very same element that failed in the first place. So instead of transplantation for replacing missing and damaged cells in the brain, it turned out that transplanted stem cells help the brain to help itself. And I would like to take you through the journey of how this came into reality and then open a small window to the future. We focused our efforts to multiple sclerosis, the most common cause of neurologic disability in young adults, non-traumatic disability, and MS is really tough. And we thought, we wished that maybe we could offer some hope to our patients whom we accompany along the course of the disease. The disease is caused by recurrent attacks of the patient's own immune system against their brains. Basically, the immune cells attack the nerve coverings, the myelin, which cover the nerve extensions, the axons, and strip them naked. Now, myelin coverings insulate axons very similar to coverings of electrical wires. And they also support the axons with nourishment. So once naked, the axons become dysfunctional and they cannot survive for a long time. So after chronic loss of myelin, there is eventually loss of brain wiring. And obviously, brain wiring is necessary for the different parts of the brain to talk with each other and for the brains to transmit orders to the body. So loss of wiring leads to dysfunction, disability, problems in walking, in seeing, in sensing, and so on. MS patients, often in the early phases, they recover functionally. But in the later, chronic phase of the disease, the brain has exhausted its reserve and cannot support anymore the survival of its nerves and axons, and the patients deteriorate into chronic disability. So how can we prevent that from happening? Seemingly, this is simple. If we rebuild or regenerate the myelin coverings, then that will restore function and prevent further injury and dysfunction. Now, the myelin is produced by a specialized type of brain cell called oligodendrocyte. So the original thought was to transplant stem cells that can generate oligodendrocytes in the host brain to regenerate myelin and therefore to restore function and prevent disability. And with that thought in mind, we first went to learn how to grow these brain stem cells and transplanted them into the brains of mice. We transplanted the cells to mice that have a disease called experimental autoimmune encephalomyelitis. This disease is caused by triggering inflammation in the brain with an immune attack against the myelin in the mice brain, very similar to human MS patients. And we followed these animals, their clinical course in transplanted animals and in controlled non-transplanted animals. And what we observed is that while sick animals had significant difficulties in walking, the transplanted animals could walk much better. So we asked ourselves how this happens. Did the transplanted cells indeed become oligodendrocytes and regenerate myelin in the brains of the mice? And to answer that, I would like to share with you for a minute some of the difficulties and frustrations of scientific research. Think for a minute. Our brain is inside that closed box, and how can you tell what's going on inside? For example, how can you identify the cells that you have transplanted to the brain? It's like finding a needle in a haystack. Or when do you take out the brain for pathological inspection? Obviously, the single snapshot of a pathological inspection may not represent the dynamic processes that are going on. And most important, how can you tell whether the cells that you have introduced to the brain really act the way you thought they will? Maybe they induce their effects by a different mechanism. So we labeled our cells prior to transplantation in a way that will enable us to recognize them in the host brain and differentiate them from the host brain's own cells. And we took out brain tissue for pathological inspection at different time points, different stages of the disease. And we first saw that the transplanted stem cells can migrate large distances in the brain. In fact, we found that it is the disease itself that attracts the brains to migrate from the site of transplantation to the multiple sites of disease and injury. And this is extremely important for regenerative cell therapy to be successful. And then we looked for a regeneration of myelin in the transplanted brains. And we looked and looked more, but could not find any myelin produced by our transplanted cells. Now, this is what one may call a failed experiment, because our hypothesis was wrong. As a scientist, I can tell you that it is quite rewarding when your experiment succeeds and you prove your point. But it is much more interesting and much more rewarding when your experiment finds different things. It makes you rethink your ideas and generate a new hypothesis, a better one. And what we finally did find was that the transplanted cells inhibited the inflammatory process in the brain. The transplanted cells prevented the immune cells from activating and from inflicting injury to the brain. So, while we first thought that transplanted cells will repair myelin, it turned out that transplanted stem cells prevented myelin from being injured in the first place. And then we went on and performed additional other experiments, and we found that transplanted stem cells can also activate the precursor cells of the brain, the brain's own precursor cells, to proliferate, to differentiate into oligodendrocytes, and to repair myelin in a better fashion than they would have done otherwise. The red staining on the left that you see represents the amount of myelin in the white tracts of the mouse brain, of a sick mouse brain. And in the right side, this is in transplanted animals in which the transplanted stem cells awakened the mouse own precursor cells to repair myelin in a better fashion. So these findings caused a major conceptual shift in the field from that of cell replacement therapy to neurotrophic and neuroprotective support by transplanted stem cells. And it opened new options and new rationale for regenerative cell therapy in multiple sclerosis, introducing cells to the brain in order to inhibit the injurious inflammatory process, to protect the brain cells from further injury, and even to promote its self-repair. But the problem was to find a proper cellular platform that can be used in the clinic on real patients. And it turned out from work performed in several laboratories in the world that the functional properties that I have just described to you on brain stem cells are shared by various types of stem cells from other tissues. And in particular, it was found that a certain type of stem cells that can be derived from the bone marrow of the patient has similar therapeutic properties like our brain stem cells. So this opens new possibilities. It is possible to aspirate bone marrow from the patient by a relatively simple procedure, to grow these rare stem cells to a large quantity in the culture dish, and here is that's in clean rooms that are suitable for human therapy, and then to introduce the cells back to the patient's spinal fluid from which the cells can disseminate and induce their beneficial effect on the brain and spinal cord of the patient. And my colleague in Hadassah, Dimitrios Karousis, took this very, very big challenge and led the first clinical trial that studied this approach of bone marrow-derived stem cells and into the spinal fluid. We first tested the safety of this procedure, and we indeed found it to be quite safe. But we also observed that many of the transplanted patients improved clinically, and this is after having failed the standard medication for multiple sclerosis. So we are enthusiastic now, and we are just about to start the next phase clinical trial where we really hope to prove the efficacy of this approach. So we are well within an era of revolution in regenerative cell therapy for the brain. But is this the end? Are these the limits that we could expect from cell therapy for neurological diseases? We want more. First, we still envision using stem cells that will actually repair the brain. And in the case of multiple sclerosis, we want stem cells that can generate myelin-forming cells in the brain. And with that in mind, we teamed with Ben Rubinoff, who is an expert on human embryonic stem cells. These are the stem cells, the original stem cells that generate the entire repertoire of cells in our bodies. And we learned how to grow them and to direct them into becoming brain cells and specifically into oligodendrocytes. And these are the cells that we hope will prove to be our heroes the super stem cells, those stem cells that will be able both to repair directly myelin and at the same time induce the repertoire of therapeutic properties of stem cells, inhibiting inflammation, protecting the brain and promoting self-repair. And to test that, we have now teamed with Siddharthan Chandran from the University of Edinburgh in the UK and Ben Rubinoff, and we are transplanting these cells into animal models with multiple sclerosis to see whether this is the case. But the horizons may be even wider than just multiple sclerosis. These therapeutic properties of stem cells must say something on their normal physiological role in the brain, because all of us have stem cells in our brain sitting there throughout our lives. All of us. What are they doing there? I believe that they do not just sit there waiting for injury and repair. I believe that it is their physiological role to monitor the brain environment and to shape it towards a healthy one. And I believe that it may be their failure to do so that contributes to conditions of illness, like in aging and in neurodegenerative diseases, such as Alzheimer's disease. So perhaps if we learn how to strengthen the function of these resident adult brain stem cells, we can help the brain to protect itself from degenerative processes like in Alzheimer's disease and other neurodegenerative disorders. So does this mean that stem cells define the age of the brain? Or if we revive the stem cell pool of the brain, maybe we can rejuvenate the entire brain? I will leave you with that thought and what it holds for the future. With a never-ending story of science, just think what the story may be a few years from now. Thank you.